So hello and welcome everybody. I think most of you know me, but I think many of you probably already have heard at least also of the guest that we have with us, and the person with whom I will have a conversation is a good friend and I was going to say a former colleague, but still a colleague at the School of Transnational Governance at the European University Institute in Florence. His name is George Papakonstantino. And he's also, aside from being an academic and someone that has written extensively on a variety of economic issues, and particularly questions of fiscal policy and monetary union, has also lived as a policymaker through one of the most serious crises that Europe has faced in the recent future, in the recent past. In fact, we were saying the more serious and dramatic crisis that Europe had faced in many years, now no longer the case, being replaced by the current pandemic and the impact that this pandemic will have on the economic and social crisis. George Papakonstantino was a Minister of Finances that had the difficult task of negotiating and implementing the financial assistance program that Greece was forced to negotiate with the European Union. He arrived at the worst moment possible in government to have to negotiate that and that to have to implement and apply and enforce that very difficult program. But he was also a minister in charge of, among other issues, environmental affairs in Greece. So he's uniquely placed to not only talk about the economic recovery package that the European Union is developing and put in place to support its member states, you know, social crisis, but also in comparing that with what happened at that time and in putting that also in the context of the environmental challenges that the European Union and the world in general faces and that are one of the topics of the Green West. So George, thank you so much for having accepted to have this conversation with me. It's a pity that you weren't able to do it here in Lisbon. It will be much nicer by the sea. But it's always a pleasure to talk with you. Let's start a little bit, perhaps, with a comparison on how the European Union has reacted to this crisis and now reacted to the crisis of 2008. How different has it been, and what explains those differences in your view?
It's a pleasure, Miguel, to be talking with you. Thanks for the invitation. Until this year, we thought that we were talking about the big crisis, and it was, of course, the Eurozone crisis that hit all our countries. Of course, now we are more humble because we've been hit by an even bigger crisis in terms of drop of GDP. If you look, for example, how much GDP is going to drop in 2020, it's going to be twice as bad as it was in 2009, which was the worst year of the Eurozone crisis. But what is interesting when you're comparing the two crises, first of all, they're fundamentally different. That crisis was a banking crisis and a sovereign debt crisis. So in some countries like Ireland, it was more the banks. In other countries like mine, Greece was more an issue of fiscal balances. And it was a crisis that hit particular countries, and other countries were not touched that much. This crisis is a symmetric crisis and that hits everyone. It's an exogenous crisis because it's not an economic crisis, it's a health crisis, which has economic implications. From a policy point of view, what is interesting is that this time around, our reactions are much better than the last time. So if you compare how the different actors are behaving this time, they're much faster, much quicker to take the right decisions. We're not out of the woods, but we're certainly pulling all the stops, whereas we didn't do that last time. So from national governments, we're very quick to come in and try to either give cash to households, extend guarantees to firms, come up with all sorts of programs to be able to keep as much of the economy as they could going. To the various European institutions. So the European Central Bank has this time acted much faster than it did. In a sense, it has done in 2 months what it took it 2 years to do last time around. the European Commission.
But probably nothing of that type would have been possible without the lessons of the crisis of 2008. That's the link between the two, isn't it?
The famous whatever it takes phrase of Mario Draghi, for example, took 2 years to be uttered. When now we were whatever it takes pretty much from day one. Think of the European Commission. The European Commission back then was just adamant about sticking to the Stability and Growth Pact and keeping low deficits. Now, from day one, it realized it had to suspend the rules, the fiscal rules, because that was the only way to deal with the problem. And perhaps most important difference is how the European Council has reacted and what our collective response has been. Back then, we were what was dominant was a moral hazard, the fear that if you come to the rescue of countries, they won't do the necessary reforms that they had to. Now people realize that this is not the right approach. And what we've seen is the huge combined packages of the multi-annual financial framework, which is over 1 trillion euro, together with the crisis-specific instrument of 750 billion euro. So the two together are a very powerful way of to recover, to help countries recover.
But even if we recognize that, can we not say that in the medium term, the economic and social impact will be rather asymmetric anyway? Because even if you have that combined impact, the national side of that answer, it's rather different depending on the fiscal capacity and the leeway that different states have, depending, for example, on their levels of debt or of public debt. Germany, for example, is responsible almost by itself for more than 50% of the aids that are being given to companies and other economic actors in the European Union at the moment, because they have, independently of the EU rules, they have a leeway and the capacity to intervene that other states don't have. And if we understand that, it means that even with the EU's package that will be applied and will compensate and will support the weaker states and those that are in a more fragile economic and fiscal and budgetary position, it will still probably mean that the speed of the recovery will vary a lot between different member states, and that may end up bring tensions on the internal market, on how the European Union works. And second, if indeed the recovery will be different for some member states, can we not expect that in some of these member states, we may end up, maybe the market now are not pricing enough the sovereign risk of some of these countries. But isn't it possible that in 2 or 3 years, the states that will take longer get out of the crisis, precisely because they started with a weaker fiscal position, might find themselves in trouble in fiscal terms again, in terms of the cost of their debt? If that is so, can we continue to expect the path to recovery, continued support on the part of the ECB and continued support from the European Council in case it will be needed, in case this crisis will become for some of these states in 2, 3 years, even 4 years, a financial crisis? Is there a risk of this happening in your view? And can we have that kind of risk? Because it's a genuine question and a genuine doubt that I have. Those two problems, in my view, continue to loom in the horizon, and I'm not sure if the European Union will be in a position to deal with.
Absolutely, the risks are real. It is an asymmetric crisis. It is a symmetric crisis with asymmetric effects, because if you're a weaker country, if you start with a much worse fiscal condition, you cannot afford the 5, 6, 7 points of GDP it takes to be able to stay above water at the moment. So not everyone is going to come out of this in the same way. This is, of course, the logic which underlies the Council's decision to go for the first time for fiscal transfers. So the logic behind that, and to borrow at the level of the European Community, the European Commission, and not have an intergovernmental loan mechanism like we did before. Because if you went with the same kind of instruments we used in the past crisis, then the additional debt would simply be piled onto countries which already have high debt.
And the impact will be even more asymmetric, yeah, and risky.
But at the end of it, the direction we took was the right one. There's no question about it. There is a big question mark about whether the extent of the decisions we've taken will be enough to avoid the kind of...
The national component is still significantly big to risk putting some countries in danger along a path of fiscal consolidation.
Well, for some...
Do you think that is so?
Think of it. I mean, national budgets are about 40%, let's say, in countries. The EU budget is 1%. If you add this additional extra, comes to almost 2%. That's it. Okay, and then you disperse it in a different way. For example, for some countries, it's going to be 6, 7, 8% of GDP. Yeah. So we are channeling funds more to those that are needed. Part of those funds are pure grants, transfers, so they don't add to the debt. Is that going to be enough? There's a lot of analysts that are looking at it and saying it's not going to be enough to avoid further divergence that we currently have. And that divergence will come at a number of levels. For example, you mentioned that Germany by itself accounts for more than half of loan guarantees in the total in the EU. And that is true. And at the end of the day, German companies will be able to survive because they have been backed up by loan guarantees that are very generous. Companies in other states may not be able to survive. So you're going to have a concentration and a yet more divergence between the more prosperous parts of the EU and the less prosperous parts. So this is a real danger. And I do think that we've taken the right decisions, but we have not yet gone to the extent that we should be going in trying to avoid this kind of divergences. We'll have to do correctly.
You think the risk is only divergency. You don't see a risk of another, of this crisis becoming what it is at the moment, that is becoming a fiscal crisis, a financial crisis, a debt sustainability crisis in some of these member states?
Well, a lot will depend on the broader environment interest rates, which at the moment is benign, okay, very low or negative. And of course, the role of the ECB, because the ECB has been quick to come in and buy assets, you know, through the pandemic emergency program, which is very large. It has done it in a way that goes beyond the normal capital key. So it has given itself more flexibility. Now, the question is, until when will it continue to do that? Because it's going to, if this is something that the ECB will do forever, then the problem that you're worried about is unlikely to appear. But will the ECB be allowed to do this forever? Will there be a backlash? We've seen the problems with the German Constitutional Court. And this is a tougher decision that the ECB has taken compared to the decisions that it took back then. So if there's a new... recourse to the German Constitutional Court, the problem will start again. So at some point, the ECB will draw a line. Where will that be? Once the ECB draws that line, then that problem that you're mentioning, aside from the diversions, is going to rear its ugly head. Yes, it's going to be, you know, spreads are going to go back up, and the ability of countries to finance themselves in international markets will be severely curtailed.
Even this limited optimistic version that we're talking about depends on the economic recovery package that the European Union set up, and that, as you say, basically doubles what is the usual level of financial transfers from the European Union to the member states being in place. Now, the most recent news are not necessarily good. As you know, some member states, including Poland, now Slovenia too, decided to do the adoption of the decisions necessary for such a program, and impacting not only on this assistance, this economic recovery package, but also basically at the same time, because of the link that was established between the two, vetoed the traditional agreement on the multi-annual financial framework that determines the evolution of the EU budget for the next 7 years. So basically, not only limiting the response, the economic, extraordinary and emergency response of the Union, but even the usual disbursement of funds on the part of the Union. It's not fully surprising for this to happen. I've been saying it myself very often here in Portugal, that people took for granted, as if there were already decisions taken by the European Union, what was a political agreement between the heads of government and the heads of state at the European Council. But we have to go through a long decision-making process. And moreover, even if ultimately there will be an agreement, including with the states, we have to remind ourselves for the entire program to be set up and be in place, it needs to be ratified in practice by the national parliaments, because the own resources decision that basically increases the ceiling of own resources for the European Union, and therefore allows the European Union to go and issue the debt to finance itself in the markets, to then give this, provide these financial transfers to its member states. This decision is one of the few decisions that, as a treaty amendment, requires ratification by the different national parliaments. So, are you optimistic or pessimistic as to the, you've lived through a lot of these negotiations in very hard times. Do you think it will be possible to overcome this? Do you think that ultimately the other member states, because the Netherlands, for example, has made it clear that they will not accept anything that will not involve a conditionality as to the rule of law and fundamental rights. And this is actually, by the way, a very easy position for the Dutch, because they were not in favor of this economic recovery program the first. So if they can now frame their opposition in terms of protecting fundamental rights and the rule of law, this is the ideal position, and they will be happy to stand and not to to move in any way. Do you think there's a way to overcome this? Do you think we might even have to move into have a almost an enhanced cooperation mechanism, leaving some of the Eastern European countries, or to threaten to do that, leaving some of the European Eastern countries such as Poland and Hungary outside this economic recovery package? What do you think is possible?
What would the EU be without some drama, right? I mean, we always live through these, and especially, you know, we're in a second wave, which is has a huge human
second wave, second drama, basically. Second drama.
My sense is the following. I think, negotiations are ongoing. There was bound to be some pushback from these countries regarding the rule of law mechanism. I think it was naive if anyone thought that they would go through without any kind of pushback. At the same time, there is a reality of numbers here. And the combination of the multi-annual financial framework and the specific crisis instrument translated into funds for those countries, they're some of the biggest recipients. I find it very hard to see how they would be, until the end, be willing to block something which has such huge financial consequences for them. So I do think that in terms of a negotiation, they would have a lot to lose by sticking out to an absolutist position. Now, what's the best strategy on the side of passing this through? I think that I've been reading the last few days a temptation to sort of go back to some kind of an intergovernmental idea, to even use this as a negotiating chip on the table, saying, okay, fine, you don't want this. We can also always take this out into an enhanced cooperation mechanism or put it back into. Now, I think this is very dangerous, because I think we made a huge step forward, agreeing that as in contrast to what we did in the last crisis, we're positioning this in the very center. We're going back to the community method. We're allowing the Commission to borrow in the markets in a way it has not done before. And we're also giving part of these as grants. If we go back to the intergovernmental method, A, every single decision will have to go through every single parliament and, you know, try negotiating individual items. We've seen this in Greece in the Bundestag every couple of months. Secondly, the loans, anything that goes through that will be added to the debt burden of countries. So we're going to lose the advantage of the common issuance and the limited debt mutualization that we have at the moment. So it will be a step backwards. So I would not even think of going that direction. I think we have some time. In any case, it is clear that the funds are not going to start flowing in until mid-2021, end 2021. So the countries will, and they can at the moment, continue to fund the recovery on their own means until these instruments kick in. Let's take the time to find a compromise which preserves the rule of law mechanism, because I think on issues of principle, but also on issues of balance between different countries, we cannot give that up. Maybe there are some tweaks that can be done, but the main principle needs to stay there and find face-saving compromise that allows those countries to sign on.
Let me tell you that before I move to a different issue, that I think one possibility on which I'm actually writing an op-ed at the moment will be to seize on what the Slovenian prime minister said, that he said, basically the argument that he said is that ascertaining whether or not there's a violation of the rule of law is something for courts to do. It's not something for the political process, for the council or the commission to do. So one possibility might actually be, and that will actually reinforce the community method and actually probably reinforce the enforcement of fundamental rights, paradoxically, would be to insert the European Court of Justice into this mechanism by, for example, allowing recourse on a fast track procedure to the European Court of Justice to ascertain whether or not there was a violation of the rule of law in those member states. Might be one way to go. Seize what it was said by the Prime Minister of Slovenia, but I'm not sure if Poland and Hungary will agree with that, but it would be harder for them to oppose something of that type.
That's the kind of approach we need to be taking. Certainly not take a step back from the framework that we have created.
I agree with you. Now, I mean, this economic recovery package is linked in a lot of respects to what are now two core policy objectives of the European Union. One is the Green Deal, and the other one is the digital deal. But I want to focus on the Green Deal because that's the topic of this festival and this conference. But before I ask you about how do you think that connection can be made, and how impactful will these funds be in the environmental transformation and sustainability of the economy of the different member states, I wanted you to address perhaps what we can learn from the pandemic for how to address climate change. My reading, and I've published now a recent book with Paul Kahn, an American colleague, called Democracy in Times of Pandemic. And one of the things that we notice is that one of the things that pandemic alerts us is for the difficulty that political systems increasingly have in internalizing future risks, because the structure of political incentives often does not reward politicians that do that, all to the contrary. If early in January or December, governments would have started to shift expenditure from, for example, increasing salaries of the civil service to make investments, to prepare for the pandemic, that will likely have been extremely ample. And on the other hand, that probably would have been what they should have been doing from the moment that there were serious indications that there was a risk that the pandemic will come to Europe. And then we ended up founding ourselves not sufficiently prepared. And moreover, we now discover that even during the summer, apparently we fall into the same trap of a kind of an optimism bias that led underestimate again the risk of the second wave and what it will mean. So what we are learning now of the difficulty that the political system has in incorporating this future interest, is it relevant for climate change? Does it mirror the same challenges that, for example, as an environmental minister, you faced in developing environmental policies? The difficulty of justifying to take measures that have costs today or require investments today and whose benefits are only hypothetical and future? And how can this help us shift that, change that?
I think the pandemic magnifies the kinds of problems that we're going to have, that we are having with combating climate change. And those latter problems, the climate change related problems, are a much larger, because here we had the short-term, very acute but specific crisis where we pulled all the stops. And even in this crisis, you already mentioned how quickly in the summer, for example, the attention flagged, but we did pull all the stops. And the reason why is because short-term and benefits were pretty much aligned in the sense that you could have the sacrifices in terms of fiscal, for example, changing behavior, and you would have an immediate impact. Now, try doing this with a longer-term, a kind of slower process where we understand the science, but it is it is hard for people to internalize this in their own decision making. So it is very hard to, and for the political system, extremely difficult, because despite the fact that the problem is accelerating, it is still not within the classic time frame of a politician, which is until the next election, right? So I think we're seeing in a very condensed way the broader problems that we're facing already with climate change. And I think this is why it's extremely important that the recovery from the pandemic, which, by the way, in its own sense is also a disturbance of the natural order of things, right? Because at the end of the day, these pandemics reflect an imbalance between the human and the natural. If you look at sort of the wet markets in Wuhan and how it all started. But leaving that aside, I think it's extremely important that in our recovery instruments, we have put so central the digital transition, the green transition. So we have put it central. We are linking every single project and every reform to be aligned with our broader goals, the green and digital transitions, and that is very good. We're missing, however, one big element, and we're missing the European element in that package. We're missing the defense of European public goods around climate, the green transition. In other words, the big investments which transcend national borders, the transnational investments that are necessary are not there, because in effect,
For the energy market, for example, in terms of
the
connections between Portugal and Spain, with France, it's one thing we have been saying. Portugal.
Large transnational projects, energy, infrastructure, and other are not there. Because what we have, perhaps by necessity, are national plans. And the European public good element is sadly missing.
But do you think that necessity is also a product of the extent to which the urgency and the seriousness of the economic and social crisis makes it necessary for you to put the money in projects that are basically ready to go, and that you can that can make use of the money very fast? But if that is so, doesn't that involve a risk too, that many of these projects were not initially thought in terms of environmental sustainability or as instrumental in any way for the green transition? And what you may be seeing is a lot of pay lip service being done, but that ultimately not much will actually be done in terms of green transition? Or are you more optimist than I am somehow?
I understand the politics, and I can see completely how you know, from a national point of view, you focus on your own projects, and therefore you want something which is very specific and deals with your national priorities. That's fine. But the danger is there that, A, we're missing out on the external effects by not having larger European projects, and B, that this exercise may end up being a box-ticking exercise, where we have our criteria in these long lists that the Commission will be presenting, and that every country is so keen to have projects going off the ground that are in accordance with the criteria of going green and going digital, that they will simply find projects which are not sustainable in and of themselves and are not part of a truly sustainable transition, sustainability transition, but are simply there to make sure that we tick the box that says, yes, this is in the green category. So that's a real
window dressing projects. So that they will seem to fit the green transition when in fact it's just one way of getting the money.
And in many countries, from my understanding, is that a lot of what you end up doing is having a catalog of bottom-up projects. And then you see how they fit into your various categories. That's a recipe for a disaster. You also need to have a top-down broader framework of what, where the needs are, where you need to be moving your money to, which kind of project you need to be supporting, and not simply wait for the various ministries, the various regions, the various localities to bring you projects that you can then add to your list. So that it is a real problem. It's not one that you can solve easily. It is solved only through quality control, and there's a limit to how much the Commission can or should be doing. At the end of the day, it's also up to the individual.
I was thinking precisely that. I mean, there's this tension that is really hard to resolve, because on the one hand, you want this money to be put into the economy as fast as possible. But on the other hand, you want the money to be used in projects that are really have a transformational value in terms of the economic structures of many states. And the two things are rarely converge. And as you say, this will require a lot of quality control that will be very hard, both in terms of resources and whether the Commission could do that control on a case by case. But one possibility might be on the institutional design and the conditions that the European Union may impose on the institution at the national level will certify this. So requires some level of independence and insulation from politics, for example, of these institutions.
It's a tough equilibrium. And there's also another dimension, which is that both your country and mine have a very toxic recent history of conditionality that has become coming from the Commission that is too detailed and too interfering. And we're all politically very reluctant to get into the same kind of discussion. So, and the Commission knows this, and the Commission will not be as intrusive as it has been in the past, with the danger that at a national level, you may be able to slip things which are politically expedient, but not very. So, it comes down to governance, and it comes down to controls from the political system, from civil society, from advocates of a real green transition, to support and act as a controlling mechanism for a lot of these projects.
Okay, George, I think we've exceeded our time. Thank you so much for this conversation, and thanks to everybody that seeing us.
Thanks very much.
Okay, I think we're gone. How was everything?